Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim tasliman kathira. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammadin fil awwalin wal akhirin. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa zid wa barik ala sayyidina Muhammadin fil mala'il a'la ya arhamar rahimin. Always we begin with the praise of Allah. We send our prayers of peace upon our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We testify with firmness and conviction that none is worthy of worship but Allah, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his worshipping slave and final messenger. Having said that, I do command myself and remind myself and you of taqwallah azza wa jal. And taqwa is an inner awareness, it's a consciousness that you and I seek to develop in our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it manifests and shows itself in the real life interactions we have with the people that we share this blessed earth with. And therefore your taqwa to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something that's in the heart, but it shows in the deeds. And taqwa has three integral characteristics. That it shows that you have an excessive love for Allah that's tempered by a fear of Allah. And therefore there's this balance where you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you're also conscious of your duties to Him. And the balance between the love and the fear that you have is an overwhelming hope in the mercy of Allah azza wa jal. Now first, I'd like to be very gracious in my thankfulness to the Islamic Foundation of Toronto, especially the youth section. Jazakumullah khair for allowing me this space and this time with you. It's actually really weird sitting in this gym because I used to play ball here. I'm just saying, it's actually pretty good actually. So if you want to kick it a little bit afterwards, we can do that inshallah. But I was born and raised in Canada, so I thought I'd give you a little bit about myself. And I memorized the Quran at Masjid Tariq. Tariq and Region Islamic Center, right? Now there used to be an imam there, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower him with his mercy, may Allah have mercy upon him, Sheikh Hamid Jabir. Now the elders over there sitting in the back, they're like, oh yeah, I remember that name. Sheikh Hamid was my first Quran teacher, and I memorized the Quran while I was in high school. And it was in grade 11 and 12 that I kind of got into wanting to learn the Quran. And when I finished it, I said, so what does it mean? Because it's one thing to be able to parrot it and to sing it and to regurgitate it, but it's a totally different thing to be able to function with it and understand it and practice it. And I thought I'd share that as an entrance to my discussion with you today. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide all of you His bounty and His favor. And of the greatest bounty and favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give you from the words of the Prophet ﷺ is خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. The best of you is the one who can master the Qur'an and be given the honor, the privilege to teach it to others. In another hadith, the hadith of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. The one who Allah desires for them, wants for them goodness in this life, Allah gives them an understanding of this religion, not a practice of the religion, but an understanding of how to practice the deen. My topic with you today, inshallah, and I promise it'll be about 20, 25, maybe 30 minutes at the most, because I'd rather discuss than lecture. I lecture all the time, but I'd rather discuss with you because I have, mashallah, a captive audience. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you that ease that you feel free to ask me what you want. I'm an educator by profession, so I run a school of 1,000 plus children. I'm an assistant deputy principal, and I'm an educator at university. So at University of Western Australia and at Curtin University, I'm in administration and I function as their imam and chaplain and other things. So my life is dealing with you. And there's nothing that you have as a question or a comment that will phase me and that will be like, I've never heard that before, because I've heard it before. And I would rather that you have an opportunity, especially with this iPad thing going around, where you can ask what you want. And there will be times where I say, listen, la adri, Allahu alam, I really don't know. But I'll try to find out, and you can email me. My email is very easy. It's yahyaibrahim@almaghrib.org or yahyaibrahim@hotmail.com/gmail.com/yahoo. I got them all, bro. I'm an OG from way back. When they opened Hotmail, I was like the first guy. I was like, that's how old I am, right? So yeah, so I got all of them. Yahya Ibrahim as one word, email me, inshallah, okay? And you can also on social media, I know you guys don't use Facebook, but can you find me on Instagram, right? Facebook for your parents, Instagram for you guys. All right, you can find me on that, inshallah, and you can hit me up with a DM. I'll do my best, inshallah, to answer it. So the topic that I want for 20, 25 minutes is how to affect change. And I don't mean change in other people, but change in yourself. If you're sitting in front of me now, if I'm sitting in front of you now, and in my mind, I don't have something that I desire to make a change in, I'm not functioning in an optimum capacity. There's something wrong with me. Now, it could be one of two things. It could be a delusion of grandeur that I think, wow, I'm so perfect, there's nothing I need to work on. And Allah says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ, that may Allah forgive for you the things that were indiscretions in your past. Even you, ya Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you need to transcend, you need to keep going. The Prophet would finish the prayer as we just prayed Salatul Maghrib upstairs, and the Prophet would make the dua that the Imam made after the Salah. Allahumma inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. Oh Allah, assist me, because I can't do it on my own, to thank you more and to praise you more and to worship you better than I just have, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That mindset of affecting change within myself, but more importantly, affecting change in others. So I'm going to throw out two words, and I want to see if you know the difference between them. What does the word salih mean? Salih. What does it sound like to you? Is it a pious person? A pious person, mashallah. Don't, you know, shout it out. You know it. Salih is a righteous person. What about muslih? Sounds the same. Salih is you're a good guy. Muslih is you allow through your behavior others to become good people. Now that's a big thing. It's really easy for you to say, listen, I pray, I fast, I listen to my parents, mashallah, I do my best at work, at school, alhamdulillah, I got it under control. I got time for Quran, I listen to the lectures, mashallah, I come to the masjid for salah, I'm part of this youth group in the masjid. Alhamdulillah, ana salih. I'm not like these rubbish people out there. I'm not running the streets, I'm not doing this and that. Alhamdulillah, I don't smoke, I don't do this and that. I'm a good person. Ana salih. That's nice. But there's another part to it, which is to be muslih. Nobody bothers you when you're a good person. People are like, oh, he's a good person. But the moment you step forward, see, the Prophet ﷺ, before the message was delivered, everyone saw him as salih. He was a good person. He was what? What was his nickname? As-Sadiq al-Amin. He's a good guy. Everyone got along with him. But the moment he came and said, hey, listen, I'd like to help you become a better person. Don't worship the thing. It's not good for you. It doesn't hear you. It doesn't do anything for you. They're like, hold on a second. You're okay on your own being salih, but don't come into my life and try to change and affect a change. Even if you think it's positive, even if it is calling to positive, you stay on your side, I'm going to stay on my side. And therefore that second part, the affecting of change in others, becomes the basis of true righteousness in our deen. You can't just sit in a corner. The Prophet ﷺ says, in the authentic hadith of Imam Muslim, he says, مَثَلُ الَّذِي يُخَالِطُ النَّاسِ وَالَّذِي لَا يُخَالِطُ النَّاسِ. The difference in the example between the one who mixes with people and the one who sits at home as a recluse, who sits in the masjid, he's just in front of the Qibla all day reading Quran, doesn't get involved with anyone else, he doesn't get involved in society in its greater extent. They just sit and say, I'm just going to worship Allah, I'm not going to get involved with anyone else. And the one who does get involved, وَيَتَحَمَّلُ أَذَاهُمْ, and because they get involved, they have to bear the burden of what other people put them under. Sometimes there's going to be sarcasm, sometimes it's going to be abuse, sometimes there's going to be ridicule, sometimes. The one who goes out and mixes is more beloved to Allah than the one who sits in the masjid and does nothing but worship Allah and not get involved with others. Because one is salih, but the other is muslih. It's a powerful word. Whenever you hear that word in the Quran, you see it attached to the prophets of Allah. Shu'aib, he will say, إِنْ أُرِيدُ إِلَّا الْإِصْلَاحَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُ. I only want to make islah, I only want to help you to become a better person. Lut says the same thing, Nuh says the same thing. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said the same thing. So let's talk about how to make effective change. Point one is yourself. In Arabic we have this concept, it's an Islamic concept as well. فَاقِدُ شَيْءِ لَا يُعْطِي. The one who possesses nothing has nothing to give. I want you to always think about that. You don't have Quran, you can't teach Quran. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ. The best of you is the one who learns and then can teach. It's not the one who just teaches. You got to learn to teach. You got to acquire, gather, keep, practice, and pass on. And that's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Iqra, read. The word iqra is a very beautiful word in the Arabic language. It means to read something, but not internally. Iqra means that you're audible so that you hear yourself and the one next to you can hear you to benefit from what you yourself are reading. The word iqra also comes from qurut, meaning something that is visited regularly. It's all the time. And therefore, for example, for our sisters, the menstrual cycle is called qurut. It's a regular visitation, it's a regular habit. The Quran has that same process. It's meant to be read aloud all the time, regularly, so that everyone can take benefit from it past yourself. So the Prophet ﷺ demonstrates that very powerful example of receiving and focusing within himself before extending to others. So when I say to myself and to yourself, to affect change, I know it sounds a bit strange, but hear me out. I want you to develop the great habit of being self-centered. Here you say what, brother? I thought we were supposed to be like, you know, caring about others and stuff. Yeah, you can care about others after you care about who. Who do you care about first? Yourself. Listen to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. He says, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحبه لنفسه. You can never be a true believer, completion of faith. You can never accomplish it until you love for others what you love for your. Which means I need to know what I love for myself, what I value for myself before I could say I value it for him. This is what I love. I love free time. I love to read. I love to have a little bit of disposable income, that I have a little bit of savings, that I can buy something that I want. These are things that I love for myself. I love to have time with my family. I love to learn. I love to teach. Now that I know these are things, I love Allah. I love to be able to have my dua heard and answered by Allah. These are things I love for myself. Now for me to be a true believer, it can't stop here. When I say I want you to be self-centered, I'm not saying I want it just for myself. That's the problem. That's the bad self-centered. A good self-centered is you say, I'm going to begin with myself. And I know some of your parents, you know, this is live broadcast and I'm sure they'll watch it at some point. I know that it's being recorded. Sometimes parents, they don't like when I say this. And it's not because you're young that I say this, but I'm going to say to you, sometimes your parents don't always have your interest in mind. And sometimes your parents will request of you to do something that isn't right. Could you imagine if the Prophet ﷺ listened to his uncle, who was his caregiver? He's like his foster parent. Could you imagine if the Prophet ﷺ stands on the mountain of Safa and he tells people about Allah, and his uncle, who Allah then later condemns and calls him Abu Lahab, his uncle, his blood uncle, his father's brother, the man who spent wealth on him, educated him, nurtured him when he was younger, says to him, stop talking. Who said you can talk like this? Get down from that mountain. We don't want to hear this. Could you imagine the Prophet said, well, I got to respect my elders. I got to, you know, that's it. La. There's moments in life where a person who has authority over you, a right over you, may not have your interest in mind, may request of you to do something that is not right. And I say to you by the command of Allah, not me saying it to you, that the Prophet ﷺ says, لَا طَاعَةَ لِمَخْلُوقٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةَ الْخَالِقِ. There's no obedience to someone when it means you're going to disobey the one who created you and them. A really vivid example is even how people disobeyed the Prophet ﷺ and he liked it. The Prophet of Allah, you're commanded, أَطِيعُ اللَّهُ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولُ. Obey Allah and the Messenger equally. You can't even have in your heart anything that makes you feel, I don't like what he asked me to do. You can't even have that in your heart, let alone disobey. But imagine his cousin, the husband of his daughter, destined to be the fourth of the Khulafa, one of the righteous, most righteous of the Ummah, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. The Prophet gives him a command face to face and he says, I'm not going to do it, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To the Messenger of Allah, like, could you imagine the Prophet ﷺ says, hey, do this, and you're like, no. What? Ali did that. On the day of Hudaybiyah, Ali radiallahu anhu is the scribe. And he's writing a contract between the people of Quraysh and the Prophet ﷺ. And Ali begins the contract, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And they said, we don't know these words. Rather write, Bismikallahum, in the name of Allah, the one who is worshipped. Don't say Bismillah, that's your Quran. So Ali, the Prophet says, erase Ar-Rahman Rahim and write Bismikallahum. All right, he listens. This khita, this contract, بين سهيل بن عمر ومحمد رسول الله. سهيل بن عمر says, hey, if I believed he's the messenger of Allah, Rasulullah, why would we need a contract? Take out the word Rasulullah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ali is like, I ain't ever going to do that. I will never remove the title Muhammad Rasulullah. So I said. Suhail ibn Amr says, then we have no deal. The peace treaty is over. So the Prophet ﷺ turns to Ali radiallahu anhu and he says, Ya Ali, erase it. He says, no, I'm not going to do it. I love you too much to do it, Ya Rasulullah. I'm not going to take that title. That's the title Allah gave you in the Quran. Muhammadun Rasulullah. He disobeys the Prophet ﷺ face to face. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because there's no obedience in that kind of concept. Ali understood it. So the Prophet smiled. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet took the paper and he erased it. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The humility of the Messenger of Allah. I want you to be committed to your life. I want you to be very self-centered. I want you, my dear sister, that, you know, there might come a time that you're helping your mom or something and you have a test, you have an exam. You have something that's really important. You need to explain it to your parents. This is really important. I can't normally help you as I normally do every other day of my life. I'll do a double tomorrow, but this is important. I got to put myself first. Because there's a reason for it. And there's a command from Allah. And I'm not going to take the hijab off. I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do that. Because this is Allah. This is my relationship with Him. Think of that moment of Ali radiallahu anhu's disobedience to the Messenger of Allah. Build your life around yourself. But the moment you know what you like, what you want, what's important, what's really important in life, be willing to love it for other people and want other people to possess it equally. So you want success? Don't make it at the expense of others. Sometimes you'll find people that they want to be successful, so they'll put somebody else down. You want friends, so to get friends, I'm going to bully this person. I'm going to put this person down because it'll make me look cool to these people. And it's at the expense of them that I think I will rise. And I say to you, my dear brother, my dear sister, that there is no ascension at the expense of anyone else. And the Prophet ﷺ would make that clear in every aspect of his life. So the first principle to affect change is put yourself first. Think of yourself. Second is understand your place in this world and what power you actually possess. Regularly, people will lie to you. Like growing up, people used to lie to me. They say, Yahya, if you work hard, you can achieve anything. I'm here to tell you, that's nonsense. It hurts. You could work so hard, and then you look to the right, and there's someone who worked half as hard as you and got more than you. That's it. You can work so hard, and someone who did nothing exceeds you. I've had people get the job that I thought, subhanAllah, this job is made for me. That's it. I've got the right qualification, the right experience, everything. And that person who's sitting there, they got nothing. And then they're sitting in the chair you think you should be sitting in. That's life. Life is not meant to be analyzed in the sense that, you know, if I just give it more time, if I work harder. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not telling you just to sit back and be lazy and say, oh, okay, brother, yeah, mashallah, you made it real easy. Is that how I get to medical school? I didn't know that. I just don't study? No. What I want you to understand by that is people will tell you things to try to motivate you. But sometimes they give you this false sense of security. And I'm here to tell you that as hard as you work, I want you to know that there will be moments in your life where you will be disappointed. And as much effort as you put, as much hope as you have, as much dua as you prayed, as much money as you spent, as much time and energy that your parents, yourself, your friend, whatever it is, in whatever venture, I want you to always be prepared that Allah may take from you something that you love so much, thinking that I must have it. Shaykh al-Islam ibn al-Qayyim, he said, never does Allah close a door in your face except it's out of His wisdom. And of every door that is closed, He will open two doors out of His mercy. So you're like, I gotta get that. I gotta achieve that. And you never get it. And it's almost as if Allah's making hurdles and impediments and it's just not happening. I can't find a solution to it. I can't get there. Know that there's a wisdom in Allah keeping you from that thing you desire so much. But equally know that Allah will open for you a doorway to something you overlooked out of His mercy for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third part of what I want to say to you is, people will say to you, you can change the world. Have you ever heard that? If you just try harder, you know, if we get together, we can change the world. I'm here to ruin that idealistic thought as well. You will never change the world. Sister, you're never going to change the world. This world is too big for you. There ain't nothing you're going to do that's going to change the world. You're not going to solve the Palestinian crisis. You're not going to bring an end to ISIS. You're not going to be able to do it. But I'm going to tell you what you can do. You can't change the whole world, but you could change one person's world. Two people's world. 10 people's world. With maybe a little bit of the savings, alhamdulillah, even as a student that you have, you can change a refugee's world. Someone who doesn't have a jacket. Like, you know, when you look at that sign back there, mashallah, human concern, they got a sign, $80. You can't even buy a pair of Nikes for $80. How much are Nikes here? 120. You can't even buy a pair of shoes. Like if you were to take out two of your friends to a restaurant to go to Bamyan or whatever you guys love over here in Toronto. I've been out of here for a while. Oh, Bamyan kebab and all this kind of stuff. It's pretty good, mashallah. You two, three people, you're gonna order food for more than $30, $40, $80. A meal for a family exceeds that. But you can give clothing for a whole winter season, like for a family, clothing, food, fuel to light a fire, to give them warmth for $80. You can't change the world, but you can change that family's world. That is a powerful, powerful effect that you can cause in another person's life. I have this thing, I don't know, you guys are privileged here. You know, when I come back to Canada, I get drunk on Tim Hortons coffee. Because it's like $1.77. Like a small coffee in Australia is like $4.50. Like a, you know, this little, and it's that Italian small, it's like an espresso, $4.50. You come here and you guys, your small is like a triple extra large anywhere else in the world except America, right? Americans lead the world in excessiveness. $4.50. You can actually change someone's life for a cup of coffee. Like, wallahi, $4.50, that you skip it every couple of days, you can change a person's life. It's like food on the table for a family. $20 a month, $30 a month. It's incredible. And it's about thought. So I began by saying to you, I want you to be self-centered. But it's not in the way that you think. I want you to put yourself first. I want you to put your education first. I want you to put your Quran first. I want you to put your Iman first. I want you to put your friends second. I want you to put, you know, other things second. Your path to success must come first. But number two is, now that you know what you want, what you care for, make it something that you're willing to leverage to pass on to others. Because the best of you is the one who gathers and then gives. خَيْرُكُمْ مِنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنِ but also teaches it. There's no, it's as if the Prophet ﷺ is saying that there's no good in the one who learns the Qur'an but doesn't teach it. And in fact, you have this hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he talks about four different types of people who deal with our faith, in particular the Qur'an. He said there's one, a believer, who's like a sweet citrus fruit. They have a beautiful scent. The orange blossom is smelling, it smells incredible. The orange smells incredible and it tastes good. That's a believer who reads and practices the Quran. From a distance, they look amazing, smell amazing, and when you experience them, they're even better. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, there's another type of person. And they're like a flower that has a bitter taste but smells nice. And that's a believer who is faithful but has no Quran. They have no sweetness. They pray, they fast, but they don't care about the word of Allah to learn it and to teach it. When you see them, they smell nice, they look nice, but inside there's a bitterness, there's no Quran. Then there's another one. The Prophet ﷺ said, the third one is that they're a thorny flower. They're the ones who from the outside have the Qur'an, but they're hypocrites on the inside. So they look nice, but taste terrible, and if you actually touch them, they injure you. And the last is the one who is a bristle. There's no goodness in them, no smell in them, nothing in them. They're just shaft. They're just a piece of dead wood, timber. And they're the believer who doesn't read the Qur'an and doesn't practice the Qur'an. May Allah protect us from this. Allahumma ameen. The final thing that I wish to say to you, inshallah, before we open it up for discussion, is I want, especially when we're talking about change, I want your aim in life to not just be success, but to be broader, which is happiness. Anyone know the difference between success and contentment? Because most people conflate the two. Success is metric. Like if I say to my young brother here, Assalamu alaikum ya akhi, how successful are you with the Quran? It means, how many surahs have you memorized? How well do you read it with tajweed? How successful are you academically? What's your GPA, your grade point average? What school do you go to? What program are you enrolled in? Right? How successful are you financially? What's your net worth in comparison to your debts? And I can measure it. It's a metric scale. Success, you can measure. Happiness, you can't. See, I can look at you and you can look happy, but you might be crumbling inside. Don't lie to me. How many of you guys have seen Miss Doubtfire? Don't lie to me. I've seen it like 10 times. You've never seen Miss Doubtfire? Come on, man. Really? You don't know what you're missing. So Robin Williams is this actor that has done all these different movies. And when you see Robin Williams act, he's like the happy guy. He's the guy that makes everyone happy. Everyone always assumed that because he makes everyone happy, he's got all this success, he can walk into any store, buy anything at any time, at any cost, without thinking. It's just, he's so famous. He brings joy to everyone. And then people were kind of surprised, may Allah protect us, when he took his own life. And he left a note where he said, I brought so much happiness to everyone, but inside I found none in myself. It's like, really? The happy guy? The successful guy? Couldn't find contentment? The answer is yes. And if you want to have a successful life, build it on a premise of seeking happiness. And Allah tells us that happiness comes from that reminder that leads you to remembering Allah. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُ الْقُلُوبَ تُمَأْنِينَ is another word for contentment and happiness. That true happiness, true delight, is where your soul is at ease, is your heart is at ease in what it is that Allah has given us in life, the good and the bad. Lead your life seeking that happiness rather than simply the metric forms of success. Find your happiness in salah. Find your happiness in your giving, in your charity, in your care for others. The happiest moments in your life, if you haven't experienced them yet, as you continue to mature, it will be the kindnesses you've done unto others. Like I can tell you, when I got my first job, wallahi, I was ecstatic. I was so happy. But it was of greater joy to me. I had more happiness than when my best friend, who'd been looking for a job longer than me, I found my job before him. I started making money and got a car, and I was happy. And I keep looking, I was like, SubhanAllah, I make dua, may Allah make it easy for him. And I know how hard he worked and how hard he tried. And then there came this moment where I saw the perfect job for him. And I rang him up and I said, listen, apply to this, call this, I've talked to this, I've networked it. Inshallah, you're gonna get this job. And the moment he called me like 2 weeks later, Yahya, I got the job, wallahi, in me, there was more happiness than when I got myself my own job. Because happiness isn't about what you do for yourself, it's what you do for others. And therefore the Sahaba, they had this statement, كَانَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَسْعَدَ النَّاسِ. The Prophet ﷺ was the happiest person, صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. In Arabic culture, we have a saying, أَسْعَدَ النَّاسِ مَنْ أَسْعَدَ النَّاسِ. It sounds the same, but listen to it again. أَسْعَدَ النَّاسِ, the happiest of people, مَنْ أَسْعَدَ النَّاسِ, is the one who brought happiness to others. The happiest person is the one who made other people in their life happy. You're happier when your parents are happy with you. You're more content when you get along with your friends. You're more content when your workplace, your environment is in good balance. You're happier when your cousins and your brothers and your sisters and everybody gets along. Happiness is where you've done happiness, brought happiness to other people's life. And those are the words that I wish to leave you with, inshaAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring happiness to you. May Allah fill your life with happiness so that you might have happiness in the akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the contentment of the fulfillment of the sunnah and the love of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.